Bhagavatam, Canto 3, Chapter 20, Conversation between Maitreya and Vidura, text number 12.
Is it?
Ten to twelve. We didn't read 10, 11, and 12. Okay. So I'll read 10 and 11, and then we'll chant number 12. Number 10. Vidura inquired, "How did the prajetas, such progenitors of living entities as Marichi and Swayambhuva Manu, create according to the instructions of Brahma, and how did they evolve this manifested universe?" Text number 11. Did they evolve the creation in conjunction with their respective wives? Did they remain independent in their action, or did they all jointly produce it? Text number 12. Maitreya Uvacha Daivena Durvitarkya Durvitarkyena Parin An Imishena Cha Jata Shobhat Bhagavato Mahan Asit Guna Trayat. Maitreya Uvacha Daivena Durvitarkyena Parin Animishena Cha Jata Shobhat Bhagavato Mahan Asit Guna Trayat. Maitreya Uvacha Daivena Durvitarkyena Parin Animishena Cha Jata Shobhat Bhagavato Mahan Asit Guna Trayat. Maitreya Uvacha Daivena Durvitarkyena Parin Animishena Cha Jata Shobhat Bhagavato Mahan Asit Guna Traya. Maitreya Obacha. Maitreya said. Daivena.
By superior management.
Known as destiny. Durvitakyena.
Beyond empiric speculation.
Parena.
By Mahavishnu.
Animishena.
By the potency of eternal time.
Cha.
And.
Jatashobat.
The equilibrium was agitated.
Bhagavata.
Of the personality of Godhead.
Mahan,
the total material elements,
the Mahatattva,
Asit,
were produced,
Gunatrayat,
from the three modes of nature.
Translation.
Maitreya said, when the equilibrium of the combination of the three modes of nature was agitated by the unseen activity of the living entity, by Mahavishnu, and by the force of time, the total material elements were produced. Please repeat.
Maitreya said,
when the equilibrium
of the combination
of the three modes of nature
was agitated
by the unseen activity
of the living entity,
by Mahavishnu,
and by the force of time,
the total material elements
were produced.
Purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. The cause of the material creation is described here very lucidly. The first cause is daiva, or the destiny of the conditioned soul. The material creation exists for the conditioned soul who wanted to become a false lord for sense enjoyment. One cannot trace out the history of when the conditioned soul first desired to lord it over material nature. But in Vedic literature, we find that the material creation is meant for the sense enjoyment of the conditioned soul. There is a nice verse which says that the sum and substance of the conditioned soul sense enjoyment is that as soon as he forgets his primary duty to render service to the Lord, he creates an atmosphere of sense enjoyment which is called Maya. That is the cause of material creation. There's a few more sections in the purport, but let's take it one section at a time, because this is not an easy subject to understand and to explain. It's not very easy, so we will take it gradually. So Vidura wanted to understand about the secondary part of creation. Maitreya is beginning to describe, this is his first verse, beginning his reply, and he is explaining factors which were the cause of the creation. You know, people often wonder, why does God create the world like this? We think, oh, he's not a good creator. He created this world with so much suffering, with so many difficulties. The material world is not described to be a very happy place. Rather, we say dukkhalayam, dukkhalayam shastra. It's a place of misery. Why did the Lord create such a place? So we can understand here Srila Prabhupada is saying first cause of the creation was daiva, the destiny. It was actually destined for all of us that we would take birth in this material world. You know, people sometimes say, why is it like this? Why you do like this to me? Sometimes children complain to their parents that why it's like this? Why you're poor? Why you don't give me a lot of money? Why you don't, you know, give me all kinds of luxuries and make me happy? But we have to understand there is destiny, daiva. Everything is arranged by destiny, according to the desire and qualification of the living entity. So the living entities make the mistake of desiring to enjoy independently of the Lord. Right? We turn away from Krishna. Krishna bhulya jiva. Krishna bhulya jiva anadir bahya mukham. Right? We've forgotten Krishna since time immemorial. Anadir bahya mukham. Anadi means without beginning. It means such a long time that we cannot remember when it took place. So our desire to lord over and to enjoy the world has been with us like that. We are called nitya bada. Eternally conditioned souls. Nitya bada, eternally in the sense that we've been here in this material world a very long time. Longer than we can remember. Therefore it's nitya bada, eternally conditioned. Because we cannot put a date on when we fell into this material world. Somebody was asking Srila Prabhupada about how long we've been in this material world. Srila Prabhupada said, well, it's just like when you go to sleep at night. Do you remember exactly when you went to sleep? You know, we lay down, but we don't remember exactly what moment we go to sleep. So similarly like that, we fell into this material world. And we don't remember how long or when it happened. But why did we fall into this material world? What was the cause? The cause was our own desire to lord over the material nature. That we have this desire to want to enjoy independently of the Supreme Lord. And when we have that kind of thinking, then the Lord puts us into the material world. He's created this place to fulfill all of our desires. So we say, you get what you deserve. Sometimes, we often discuss, why do bad things happen to good people? You know, people, everybody thinking, I'm a good person. Nobody likes to admit that I'm actually a bad person. And bad things happen to bad people. Bad things don't happen to good people. But because we're bad, because our nature is bad, therefore we get bad things happening to us. And this is the nature of the material world. We have to understand if this under the control of daiva, destiny, the divine arrangement. We don't remember everything, but the super soul remembers, Krishna remembers, in the heart of all living entities, sarvasya chaham hridi sani visto matat smitir jnanam apomanam cham. Vidaischa sarveraham eva vidyam vedanta krit veda eva chaham. Lord Krishna is speaking about the super soul that is in the heart of all living entities, and from him comes knowledge, remembrance and forgetfulness. So what is that knowledge? He reminds us of our desires which we had in our previous life. And he puts us into a situation that we can fulfill these different desires. We can live our life as we want, according to our karma, according to this daiva, this divine destiny. Or sometimes we talk about providence. In the 10th canto in Prabhupada's Krishna book, Prabhupada paraphrases the words of the gopis. The gopis are speaking about that, you know, they were feeling the separation from Krishna. And the gopis say, "Oh providence, you are so cruel." Because Krishna had left their association. So providence or destiny, divine arrangement, in the Sanskrit word daivi. So we're all influenced by that. And it's not by chance, but it's all taking place due to our own forgetfulness of Krishna. Right? As soon as we forget Krishna, immediately we come into Maya. Prabhupada gives the example, or rather Krishna does Kaviraj in Chaitanya Charitamrita gives the example about the sun and the darkness. So in the presence of the sun, there's no darkness. But as soon as the sun goes, immediately the darkness comes. As soon as you put out the light, immediately the darkness. And as soon as we forget Krishna, immediately Maya comes. You don't have to call Maya. You don't have to wait. It's immediately there. Krishna Surya Sama Maya Haya Andi. Yahan Krishna Tahannahi Mayaya Adi. So Krishna is like the sun and Maya is like darkness. And so long as we are in Krishna consciousness, there's no Maya. We have to stay in Krishna consciousness. What does that mean? To stay in Krishna consciousness means to keep yourself busy in the service of the Lord by hearing and chanting, remembering, serving Him. Engaging in the nine activities of devotional service. You know, we can't think, oh, everything, I'm doing it all for Krishna, my job is for Krishna, my work is for Krishna, I'm cooking for Krishna. You know, in our minds sometimes we like to think that we're doing everything for Krishna. We say Krishna's arrangement. But actually it's Maya's, it's our own arrangement, our own plans for sense enjoyment, which puts us into all kinds of difficult situations. We get the results of our own activities. So we have to be careful to keep ourselves always engaged in Krishna consciousness. Okay, so we'll read some more of Prabhupada's purport. Another word used here is durvikarina. No one can argue about when and how the conditioned soul became desirous of sense enjoyment. But the cause is there. Material nature is an atmosphere meant only for the sense enjoyment of the conditioned soul. And it is created by the personality of Godhead. It is mentioned here that in the beginning of the creation, the material nature or prakriti is agitated by the personality of Godhead Vishnu. There are three Vishnus mentioned. One is Mahavishnu, another is Garbhodakshayi Vishnu, and the third is Shirodakshayi Vishnu. The first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam discusses all these three Vishnus. And here also it is confirmed that Vishnu is the cause of creation. From Bhagavad Gita also we learn that Prakriti begins to work and is still working under Krishna's are Vishnu's glands of superintendence, but the Supreme Personality of Godhead is unchangeable. One should not mistakenly think that the creation emanates from the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He has therefore transformed into this material cosmic manifestation. He exists in his personal form always, but the cosmic manifestation takes place by his inconceivable potency. The workings of that energy are difficult to comprehend, but it is understood from Vedic literature that the conditioned soul creates his own destiny and is offered a particular body by the laws of nature under the superintendence of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who always accompanies him as Paramatma. So Srila Prabhupada is explaining to us about the nature of this material creation, how creation comes about by the work of Vishnu. Actually, Lord Vishnu is in his different Purusha avatars is arranging for this creation of the cosmic manifestation. The living entities during the time of annihilation, they all enter into the body of Mahavishnu, and then when the period of annihilation is over, then again the creation takes place. Just like the night is followed by day. And then when the day comes to the end, then the night comes. And then after the night, then again day. So similarly, there is creation and then annihilation. And then creation and then annihilation. It's going on continually. So Lord Vishnu's work is very important in the sense that Lord Vishnu is responsible for the creation of the different universes. It is said the Lord glances over the material nature, prakriti. Now prakriti is eternal, but sometimes it's manifest and sometimes it's not. But it's eternal. All the elements, everything of the material world is eternal. But sometimes it's manifest and sometimes it's not. Just like during the day, during the time of maintenance, everything is manifest. But with annihilation, then everything becomes unmanifest. Now during that unmanifest state, the living entities, we said, enter into the body of Mahavishnu. And then when it comes time to again begin the creation, Lord Vishnu glances over the material nature. And his glance, just by his glance, he's able to impregnate the living entities into the material nature. This is inconceivable in the material world. We don't see any living entity can impregnate another living entity simply by their glance. But the Lord has inconceivable potency. Parashya Shakti Vividalvashruyate. Right? The Lord possesses inconceivable potency. This is very important that we understand that Krishna and Lord Vishnu possess inconceivable potencies. Without understanding that, we will never be able to understand the pastimes of Lord Krishna. So this is why in these early cantos of Srimad Bhagavatam, many times we are hearing about the creation. It's important for us to understand how the Lord does the work of creation. And we should think of the pastime of the Lord in creating the material world to give us, it should give us as much pleasure as hearing about Lord Krishna's pastimes in Vrindavan or Dwarka. Some people feel, oh, hearing about creation, they find it not interesting. They just simply want to hear Rasa Leela, you want to hear about Raja Leela and all these pastimes. But it's very important for us also to hear about the process of creation, what is called the Srishti Tattva, the creation of the material world. Because by understanding the creation, then we will have greater appreciation for the inconceivable powers which the world has. It's difficult for us to accept that there can be inconceivable powers. This, of course, is something which material scientists cannot deal with. Therefore, Srila Prabhupada, he said this word, durvitakyena, is very important. This means that beyond the power of speculation. We scientists and materialistic people, empirical scientists and so on, they want to understand everything by the powers of their mind and senses. But the Lord performs this work of creation is beyond the power of speculation. You may travel, it says in Brahma Samhita, it talks about Munipungavan, right? Munipungavan, that you may travel at the speed of the mind, or faster than the speed of the mind. How fast can the mind travel? Just think. In the mind, you can think of the moon, and immediately we're at the moon. So the mind can travel so fast. But even if you travel at the speed of the mind, even then, you're not able to approach the lotus feet of Govinda. Because the Lord is inconceivable. He has unlimited potency. So this is very important to understand. And that's why in the first few cantos of Srimad Bhagavatam, we're hearing more about the creation. And then we will become more convinced about the inconceivable potencies of the Lord. And then we can understand more the nature of His pastimes in Vrindavan. You know, people often talk, oh, Krishna, they say, Krishna had so many wives, and Krishna picked up the hill, and Krishna killed this demon. So that they take them all to be mundane. They do not understand his inconceivable powers. But by hearing about the creation, then we can understand better the inconceivable potency of the Lord. So it is described here, how the Lord impregnates the material nature. Just simply by His glance, He impregnates the living entities into the material nature. Of course, that glance is also helped by Lord Shiva. That Lord Shiva carries that glance to impregnate the living entities into the material nature. And the living entities enter into the material nature, and we remember our past desires, our past situation is not forgotten. Just like we go to sleep at night and we forget everything. And then when you wake up in the morning, then you remember previous day, oh, I was doing this, I have to do that. You know, all the memory of the previous day comes to us when we wake up. You don't wake up and begin a new day and forget everything which happened yesterday. Oh, you remember, oh, I'm in this situation, I've got this job, I have to do this work. You remember. And so in the same way, we enter into Mahavishnu during the annihilation, and our memory is there. We're in a suspended state, unmanifested state, and then again there's the beginning of the creation, the universe has come out of the body of Mahavishnu, and then the Lord Mahavishnu expands himself into each universe as Garbhadakshayi Vishnu, and then from Garbhadakshayi Vishnu he expands himself further as Shirodakshayi Vishnu into the hearts of all living entities. And in this way, as Shirodakshayi Vishnu, he's reminding us about our desires, what we're what our ambitions, what our goals are, how we want to work, what we want to do. So this way the material creation is going on. It's not by chance. This material world is created for a purpose. And the purpose is that one day we will become exhausted. We will become totally disappointed in our attempts to lord over the material world. And in our frustration, we will surrender to Krishna. So this is the idea that the material world is created so that one way is we will work off, we work through our karma, and then when we get completely frustrated and disillusioned about the material world, then we'll think about how to get out, how to liberate ourselves to the spiritual world. So two purposes are there in the creation of the material world. One, to entangle, to allow us to fulfill these different material desires, because until we go through it, we don't understand. We don't understand how miserable this world is. You know, we have the impression, oh, it's very nice, and everybody else looks like they're having a good time, and I think I also want to be like everybody else and enjoy. But then we understand everybody's not having a good time, that actually everybody's simply miserable and suffering and struggling with material nature. I was just talking to different devotees over the weekend, and several of them were telling me about how miserable their life is, working in factories and so on, so much stress, so much anxiety, tension, oh, so many problems are there. And they're thinking how to get out, how to get release. They're looking for the alternative lifestyle. So Krishna consciousness is that alternative. When we become serious, then we will want to surrender to Krishna. And we will want to fully engage ourselves in Krishna consciousness. And take up full-time activities in the service of Krishna. We have so many centers, but we don't have hardly any full-time devotees. We want more people to take up the activities in the centers and run the centers and look after the temples and have more activities. So much can be done. So much can be done. We just need more people to do it. And we have to be able to engage people. This is Krishna consciousness. There's so much to be done, right? We have so much preaching to do, so many programs. We don't need to worry about the factories and so on. Let other people do that. Devotees' business is to go around, to give the holy name, to chant, to preach the glories of the Lord. And then the purpose of creation is properly understood. And everyone can become successful in that way. Go back home, back to God. Right? We don't want to just remain here in the material world, taking birth again and again, coming back again and again. We've already been here many, many births. Now, by some good fortune, we have the association of devotees, and we have the opportunity to get release from the material. So Srila Prabhupada encouraged us, give this one life to Krishna. We've already tried to enjoy so many other lives, and we were never happy. We were never successful. We always suffered. So give this one life to Krishna. Dedicate this one life to Krishna. We will not be the loser. Definitely. We will get the greatest benefit. Okay, Hare Krishna. Any questions, comments, Maharaj? Any comments?
languages.
Sorry? Text 9? You want to know about text 9? Oh. Text number 9. Vidura said, since you know of matters inconceivable to us, tell me, O holy sage, what did Brahma do to create living beings after evolving the Prajapatis, the progenitors of living beings? What did Brahma do to create living beings after evolving the Prajapatis, the progenitors? What did Brahma do? So, what you want to understand? We'll read the purport from Prabhupada. Significant here is the word avyakta margavid, one who knows that which is beyond our perception. To know matters beyond one's perception, one has to learn from a superior authority in the line of disciplic succession. Just to know who is our father is beyond our perception. For that, the mother is the authority. Similarly, we have to understand everything beyond our perception from the authority who actually knows. The first avyakta margavit, or authority, is Brahma. And the next authority in disciplic succession is Narad. Maitreya Rishi belongs to that disciplic succession. So he also is avyakta margavit. Anyone in the bona fide line of disciplic succession is avyakta margavit, a personality who knows that which is beyond ordinary perception. So, Prabhupada is making the point, you know, that Vidura had asked this question, which is about things beyond our own ability to understand. He wanted to know what were Brahma's activities. How can we know what were Brahma's activities? We can only know by hearing from authorities. So that is the point. You want to understand these things which are beyond the power of the mind and senses. We can understand them only by the grace of the disciplic succession. Just like Srimad Bhagavatam. What can we understand of Srimad Bhagavatam? We have to understand it through the disciplic succession. We can't just simply read it on our own. If you just simply read the verses and don't read the purports, we won't understand anything. We have to hear from the disciplic succession. Very important. These subject matters are beyond our powers of the mind and senses, right? He's asking, what were the activities of Brahma after the creation? Well, we have to hear. People like Narada Muni, they will know what he was doing. And Brahma himself speaking. So hearing is very important for us. And hearing from the authorities is required. The authorities mean through the line of disciplic succession. When Brahma created the Prajapatis and then created other living entities. So Vidura wanted to know what was Brahma's other activities. So we will hear about the different creations of Brahma that will be described. Okay, any other questions? Okay, Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Lord Premanande.